All right. We are about to get started, and I wanted to start off by welcoming you all to the keynote lecture for the MLK celebration here at Carnegie Mellon University. We have a wonderful speaker here today, Dr. Wilson, and I'm very excited to hear what it is he has to say. But before we get started, I wanted to thank a couple people, our offices on campus, for their support in organizing and funding this event. That is the Office of the President, as well as the Division of Student Affairs here at CMU. It's an interesting time to be alive and to be in America. I'm going to be a bit blunt with that. But it's through the life and through the legacy that Martin Luther King left us that we can find some inspiration for how we can act. And there are a couple quotes in particular that I want to highlight. The first is that the ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he stands at a time of challenge and controversy. This is a difficult time, I think all of us will admit, and I'm sure that some of us are going to speak about that later today. But I want us all to take a moment and reflect where we stand in moments of challenge and controversy, and what we can do and what we should be doing more of. And the second quote is, our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. There are lots of things that matter right now to all of us. Whatever it is that matters to you, don't be afraid to speak out, for that is one of the biggest legacies that Martin Luther King left all of us. And with that, I'm going to move over or start introducing our student speaker, Chelsea Jones. She's a native of Dallas, Texas. She graduated from the University of Texas at Austin with a bachelor's in social work and a minor in African diaspora studies. She's currently pursuing her master's degree at Carnegie Mellon University in the Heinz College as a candidate for the master's in public policy and management. Prior to attending Carnegie Mellon, Chelsea was in Washington, D.C., working in the office of Congresswoman Stacey E. Plaskett of the U.S. Virgin Islands. Since developing as a youth in the inner city of Dallas, Chelsea has gained a focus on racial equity through the realms of poverty alleviation, civil rights policy, and criminal justice reform. She has dedicated her efforts to leadership and service initiatives for underprivileged populations. Most of all, Chelsea is dedicated to advancing the development of young Black women and inspiring them to follow their dreams, despite the circumstances. This semester, Chelsea will be stepping into the role of the Social Activism Chair here at Carnegie Mellon University's Black Graduate Student Organization before she heads back to DC next year to complete her degree. And on a personal note, Chelsea, I am so glad that I've got to know you while you're here at CMU. You are an amazing and wonderful person, as I'm sure many of the students from Heinz can attest. And I'm so glad for everything you've done. So with that, I will turn over the microphone to you.
Thank you all, and thank you, Daniel. So I'm the granddaughter of two pastors and the daughter of two ministers. So my entire life has been shaped by watching people stand up and speak truth to power. So I intend to honor God and my family today by doing the same thing. As many of you know, and as Daniel mentioned, I'm from the South, Texas. I graduated from the University of Texas, and there we say, what starts here changes the world. And so I got to CMU and noticed that you all say, my heart is in the works. I created my own motto. It says, my heart is in changing the world, right? Y'all supposed to laugh? Okay, laughter. Thanks. But I said that because as I speak for the next 5 minutes, it's my hope that you'll approach these words with an open mind, knowing that these come from my heart, and that while my views may not represent yours, they may very well represent those of a friend or a colleague who you've been seeking to understand, those individuals that you wish to live and work in peace with despite your differences. I believe that the best way for us to unify is to listen, not just to hear, but to understand. So the title of this presentation is, You Do Not Have to Be a Radical to Make a Radical Difference. On November 9th, 2016, a sentiment silently echoed in the hearts of many different people. The sentiment that our great nation, the United States of America, had changed for the worse. I disagree. I simply believe that America has reached a new level of awareness. Awareness of the fact that our fight for racial justice did not end with the Civil Rights Act 50 years ago. awareness of the fact that our 17-year-old American Disabilities Act did not stop people from publicly mocking those with disabilities. Awareness of the fact that someone who seemingly disagreed with every tenet that America holds dear, the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, could win a national campaign for the highest public office. So just as America has had an awakening to its reality, I think it's important that we do not just sit passively by, but that we become more self-aware. I would like to lead you in a thought exercise. I'm sure that many of us would answer no to the following four questions. One, have you participated in the rights being stripped from anyone in a disadvantaged community, whether it be people of color, people who identify as LGBTQ, people who are women, or even people who are Muslim? Two, have you ever made room for violence against women in your workplace? Three, have you ever participated in the financial oppression of your low-income friends and associates? And four, have you ever made racial or derogatory jokes or comments in front of your peers? Although we may have answered no, if we have remained silent when given the opportunity to use our voice to speak up on behalf of the oppressed, you have indeed answered yes. As we honor Dr. Martin Luther King today, we must recount his prominent positions on silence. In 1967, Dr. King exclaimed that in the end, we will not remember the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. Dr. King knew that by individuals keeping their mouths closed on the most pressing issues, they inflict violence on those who do not have a voice. He was trying to teach us that those who prefer comfort in the face of inequality are more dangerous to America than those who violently stand in opposition. I understand that there are many reasons to stay quiet. Silence is safer. Silence supports job security. Silence affords you the ability to connect with everyone but not necessarily experience life in their skin. However, your silence does not protect those friends from workplace discrimination or grant other friends the security of knowing that they will not be killed when stopped by police. So today, in reverence of a freedom fighter who sacrificed his life for us all to sit in this room together, I ask you to ask yourself, how important is your voice? If you don't leave with anything else today, I hope that you understand that you do not have to be a radical to make a radical difference. The worst thing that you can do to yourself and to your community in a time like this is to underestimate your power to make a change. Do not discount the weight of your words in the ears of your prejudiced friends or colleagues or family members. Yes, you may be the only opposing view in your circle, but how perfect of an opportunity to use your platform to plant a seed. Do not stop yourself from asking the difficult questions when instituting a new policy or plan, like how might this affect those who are different from me? Or how can this better serve those who have been underserved? And most importantly, do not forget the feeling of many on November 9th, 2016, who were shocked to realize that a man could publicly disgrace and denounce every community that makes America great and still be respected to earn the highest office in America. This is the feeling experienced by students of color as they sit in class and suffer microaggressions, comments and statements from their professors that undermine their intelligence and legitimacy as scholars. This is the feeling that Muslim women feel as they proudly wear their hijab around campus, only to be looked at with faces of fear from their peers. And it's what low-income and first-generation students feel when they struggle their whole lives just to make it to this institution, only to be held back by the lack of representation in our faculty and increasing tuition. America is made up of the silos of our existence. The pockets that we exist in are small in size, but large in impact. In order to transform America into the place that we want to see, we must actively pursue justice and equity in our sphere of influence. And if you find that your sphere of influence is only made up of those who think and act just like you do, well, there's where we can start to make a change. In Dr. King's famous letter from a Birmingham jail, he wrote describing two kinds of peace. The first he called a negative peace, which is the absence of tension. The second, a positive peace, which is the presence of justice. In honor of Dr. Martin Luther King, let us remember to seek justice, not just for ourselves, but for others. even and especially when it causes tension and makes us uncomfortable. Let us remember that the power of the people is always greater than the people in power. Thank you. Thank you. And with that, I'd like to welcome our ninth president, Dr. Subra Suresh.
That was terrific. I would like to introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. John Wilson. I've had the distinct honor and pleasure of knowing John in three different positions for both of us in three different cities. We both were colleagues together at another institution for a number of years, and we both served in the government at the same time in Washington, he at the White House and I as head of the National Science Foundation. We had an opportunity to meet periodically. And more recently, in the last few years, I called John up a little more than 2 years ago, and we were forming the first President's Global Advisory Council at Carnegie Mellon University. And I thought it was extremely important for this university to have a very forceful voice from someone who leads a historically black college in the U.S. And I knew that John was that voice. John, thankfully, immediately accepted on the phone and joined that group and has been a participant in that group. He is also currently a member of the board of overseers at Harvard University, of which where he got his master's degree. So I want to tell you a little story. Just a few weeks ago, about 6 weeks ago, my wife Mary and I and our daughters, we were in Africa on a short vacation. Christmas Eve, we were in Kenya, in Masai Mara, in the middle of nowhere, in a jungle. And we were in a lodge with very few people in it. And there were just two families and a few other visitors. So our family of four, and there was a family of 10 people. And one of the members of the family was wearing a baseball cap, thick sunglasses late in the evening. And I kept looking at him and thought, I know him. I've seen him somewhere. I know him somewhere. And I couldn't quite figure out. So finally I decided I was going to walk up to him. And we started a conversation. He said, oh, I really enjoyed my trip to Carnegie Mellon last year. So he removed his cap off and was Spike Lee. In the middle of a jungle in Kenya. So we talked about Carnegie Mellon for a few minutes, and then he said, do you know John Wilson? And John and Spike were classmates at Morehouse College, class of 1979, and he fondly recalled that. And during lunch today, Dr. Wilson was telling us about all the other illustrious graduates of the class of 1979 from Morehouse College. And you may know that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was an alumnus of Morehouse College as well. So this college has had a very distinguished record. And I'm also delighted to say that the senior leadership team of Carnegie Mellon University also now has a graduate of Morehouse College, Dr. Rodney McClendon, who joined us last July. So, John, I want to thank you for all of your various contributions at institutional level, at the national level and also to Carnegie Mellon University. And for immediately, without thinking for a second, when I called you up, inviting you to come to give this lecture, immediately saying yes, I really appreciate that. And we very much look forward to your presentation. With that, I present Dr. John Wilson.
So thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Greetings to all. I want to just give a shout out to Chelsea here because she mentioned her background, and I just want to say that it, just in the same way that she is, I think you said daughter and granddaughter of preachers, I'm the son, grandson, and great-grandson of preachers, all right? So we have some thematic consistency here. Greetings to you all, and I thank President Subra Suresh. You have a great president here at Carnegie Mellon. His greatness was very apparent to us at MIT and in the Obama administration, and it's no surprise that he's already come here and set some new records here, particularly in strengthening the place. And that's what we are all called to do. I know that Provost Jahanian wanted to be here. I know he had to leave a little early, but I appreciate his presence too. I appreciate also Chernell Smith. Everybody knows Chernell, all right? Greeted me starting last night. We had dinner. We spent, and we were in huddles today with students, and a couple of huddles with students, and it was all good. And she's a great host. I've had a great time here at Carnegie Mellon. I thank you for your kindness, and a shout out to all the students and faculty I met last night. I so appreciate the brain power here at Carnegie Mellon. A lot of sharp people. And that's a great thing. Don't take that for granted, all right? I also want to say hi to Eliana Trotman. Eliana, stand up. I want to say hi to you. Eliana is from Pitt, across the street, and you might be wondering, why am I doing this? Well, Eliana's dad went to Pitt and was a star running back, Floyd Trotman, back in the day. And her mom is my executive assistant. And I'm proud of that. So thank you for being here. So, thank you for coming over. And I want you all to know that I am no stranger to CMU. I've been here, as President Suresh said. I'm on the President's Global Advisory Council. I have such an appreciation for who you are. And what you do. And I'm going to be part of why CMU just elevates in terms of its recognition around the world as a place that goes very deep in terms of its technical expertise as well as its artistic expertise and brand. You have those in combination like no other institution. Stanford doesn't have that, Harvard doesn't have that, MIT doesn't have that, Georgia Tech doesn't have that. You are singular. And I appreciate you, and more people need to know about you and your graduates. I want to say happy birthday to Morehouse College. We are 150 years old this year, and what better time than it is now to celebrate the only institution in the world to have a graduate who has a Nobel Peace Prize, a national holiday, and a memorial in granite on the National Mall, all right? Harvard hadn't done that. MIT hadn't done that. Nobody else has done that. And that's why we gather today, because of one Martin Luther King Jr. Each and every King Day speaker is challenged to honor Dr. King by getting all of the hearers and listeners to a higher and better perspective on him, and that is my challenge today, a higher and better perspective on him, a higher and better perspective on life. So to that end, I think it's important, what I want to illuminate today is a shift that Dr. King made in his life. And I want to talk to you about this shift. Many of us, most of us focus on the I have a dream Martin Luther King, who articulated better than anybody else before or since a vision of a beloved community. King would often say, we need to make of this old world a new world. He would say, he said within hours of his untimely death, he referred to this vision as a promised land. And he said, we will all get there. And most often, though, he called it a beloved community, a place of love and justice and equal opportunity. But whatever you call it, whatever handle you use, it was his dream. It was his dream. And while he shared that dream in August of 1963, he was not assassinated until April of 1968. The world, too much of the world, does not know about the shift that he made between 63 and 68. He shifted profoundly in those 5 years, and that's what I kind of want to zero in on today. A lot happened in that time. I want to talk about what happened in that time. Just 1 month after sharing his dream, those four little girls were killed when the church was bombed in Birmingham, Alabama. Then about 2 or 3 months after he articulated his dream in 63, President Kennedy was shot and killed. 10 months beyond the dream, Cheney, Goodman, and Schwerner were lynched in Mississippi. And then Malcolm X in 65 was shot and killed. James Meredith shot and killed in 66. And after America enters Vietnam in 65, it all escalates by 67. And 1 year to the day before Dr. King is shot and killed in Memphis, and with Vietnam spiraling out of control, King takes center. He shifts from the poolside King, that is by the National Pool on the Mall, to becoming the Riverside King in Riverside Church. He delivers a Beyond Vietnam speech, and this is a very different King than the one who stood up poolside. The one Riverside is a little grittier. This is the King who said, we need a reconstruction of the entire society, a revolution of values. This is the King who said, America is much, much sicker than I realized when I first began working in 1955. This is the King who said, American democracy is flawed, both economically and socially, and the flaws are not just superficial, they are systemic. Change in America forced King to change his viewpoint and his outlook, his thinking and his strategy. He moved to a different definition of progress, and he was often enraged as he spoke. He became a much more fiery man. I found three clips of King in that last year of his life, and I want you to take a quick listen, and I'm sure his feistiness will be very apparent to you.
I'm sick and tired of power. I'm tired of the war in Vietnam. I'm tired of war and conflict in the world. I'm tired of shooting. I'm tired of hate. I'm tired of selfishness. I'm tired of evil. I'm not going to use violence, no matter who says it. Another thing I want you to understand is this, that it didn't cost the nation one penny to integrate lunch counters.
Well,
it didn't cost the nation one penny to guarantee the right to vote. But now we are dealing with issues that cannot be solved
without the nation spending billions of dollars and undergoing a radical redistribution of economic power.
Yes, yes.
And don't let anybody make you think that God chose America as his divine messianic force to be a sort of policeman of the whole world. God has a way of standing before the nations with judgment, and it seems that I can hear God saying to America, you are too arrogant. If you don't change your ways, I will rise up and break the backbone of your power, and I'll place it in the hands of a nation that doesn't even know my name. Be still and know that I'm God.
You don't see too much of that king, do you? That's the Riverside King, and he shifted to this king. He was grittier, as I said, and feistier. What caused him to shift? My analysis tells me three things: the killing of otherwise innocent people, the departure of a good president of the United States, and the start of a war of what progress looks like. That sounds familiar to me right now. Today we have the killing of law-abiding people, from Trayvon Martin to Mike Brown to Rekia Boyd, Philando Castile. We have the departure of a good president, thankfully not due to death, just a departure from office. And instead of a war in Vietnam or some foreign land, today's war is a civil war, again, over the idea of progress. That's what we're having right now, and at the center of this war is a man that we all recognize, and that's him to a degree. Now, I'm not going to get too political here, though I may a little bit. If you're like me, it was not your idea of progress to elect a man who bragged about sexual assault, or a man who attacked the Gold Star family or refused to disavow David Duke and the KKK. It was not your idea of progress to elect a man who encouraged violence at his rallies or racially profiled a Mexican judge or mocked a physically disabled man, and the list could go on and on and on. The place we're at right now in this country is, what does progress look like? A lot of people, last week's executive order on Friday was not progress. It made us ask, who are we as a country? Who are we supposed to be? And are we safer because that happened, or more unsafe because that happened? Now, you know we're in trouble when half of the country thinks that the rise of Trump is a devilish interruption, and the other half thinks the rise of Trump is a divine intervention. You know we're in trouble when we have competing ideas of progress. And here's where I want to go in the few minutes that I'm going to spend with you, that is ours to share together. Maybe just like King did 50 years ago, this is the 50th anniversary of his shift in that pivotal year, 1967, when he made most of that shift, maybe more of us need to now shift to a different mindset about what's going on in America. And I want to use the time that we have left to share three big lessons from 1967 alone. Three lessons to inform our thinking and activism in 2017, and each evokes Dr. King's outlook about education. I want to talk first about moral intelligence, second about aspiration intelligence, and third about capital intelligence. Now, first let's go back to the year 1967. I'm telling you, it was a pivotal year. The 50th anniversary of that year is the year when Howard University trained Thurgood Marshall was nominated to the Supreme Court It was the year when the first African-American mayor of a major U.S. city took office, Carl B. Stokes. It was the year when Muhammad Ali refused military service as the Vietnam War was raging. In the summer of 1967, that's when Langston Hughes, Billy Strayhorn, and John Coltrane all passed away. A big summer. It was the year when the Civil Rights Movement was hot and heavy and Black pride was at its peak. And it was a year when the incomparable Aretha Franklin recorded her song, Respect, R-E-S-P-E-C-T, Find Out What It Means to Me. I know most of you are too young, you didn't hear that, but you need to Spotify that or something, find it. My first focus in this pivotal year zeroes in on a huge controversy. These aren't big deals in 67, but the things you should know about. There was a huge controversy in 67 that learned it, that was at first a debate about Black colleges, but turned into a debate about all of higher education and its purpose. And I want you in this CMU community to think about this debate. The controversy was erupted by two professors at Harvard University. Their names are Christopher Jenks and David Reisman. They published a Harvard Ed Review article that referred to Black colleges, HBCUs, historically Black colleges and universities, Black colleges as academic disaster areas. Ouch. I mean, academic disaster areas. The headline was picked up by Time and Newsweek and the New York Times. And so HBCU leaders, Black college leaders, were very angry at Harvard and these two scholars, Jenks and Reisman. And they were so angry that they decided to get together for a conference at Howard University. They came together at Howard University to affirm the power and the contributions of Black colleges and to counter what they thought was a smear by Jenks and Reisman, these two Harvard scholars. And the opening keynote speaker, they chose very carefully. They called on Kenneth Clark, who you see up there, and next to him in the right corner is his wife, Mamie Clark. Now, these were two rock star intellectuals. They had done this famous Dahl study in the 40s and 50s to show how segregated education stimulates into the young kids crippling features of inferiority and how it's a problem. And they did a Dahl study to elevate that, and their findings were being elevated across the country, and so they were the rock star intellectual couple. And so Howard University pegged Kenneth Clark as the opening keynote speaker of this conference. And Kenneth Clark was, with HBCUs, Black colleges under attack, Kenneth Clark was expected to stand up and set the tone for the whole conference by calling, you know, Jenks and Reisman wrong and misguided and even racist. Clark was expected to set them straight. But instead, Kenneth Clark stood up and shocked everybody gathered at Howard University, a couple thousand people. And he stood up to set the tone for this conference and said, Jenks and Reisman are right. People were like, whoa. Ken, wait a minute, check yourself now. He said, Jenks and Reisman they're right. Black colleges do have obvious and flagrant handicaps. And Black colleges are academically inferior. Just do a comparison, it's obvious. And he said, it's basically because of a resource gap that needs to be closed. But then Clark surprised everybody again, and he said, the Harvard scholars were right about that, but here's what they're wrong about. Their criticism is incomplete. He said, white colleges and universities are deeply and insidiously morally inferior. He said, they're too detached and have not fulfilled their responsibility and obligation to develop and train human beings with moral intelligence and a socially responsible intelligence. Moral intelligence is what we all need to do, he said. And black colleges do it better than white colleges, but even though we're less well-equipped and may be inferior in some measurable ways. Now, Ken Clark and Martin Luther King were friends, and they, in fact, shared this viewpoint about the universal power of education. So when, you know, King was talked about education all the time. When he was a student at Morehouse, he wrote in a student newspaper, "Intelligence plus character is the goal of a true education." He wrote about it and said other things about it. So Clark was actually channeling King when he said, "We need moral intelligence." And that is not a black survival imperative. It's an American survival imperative. And he challenged black colleges and white colleges and all of higher education to be better at instilling in students moral intelligence. Equip them to do good as they do well for themselves. Moral intelligence was a thing, education for moral intelligence. And that set the stage in part for the next change that I want to talk about, aspiration intelligence. Because in that same year, 67, Martin Luther King writes his fourth and final book, "Where Do We Go From Here? Chaos or Community?" He ponders two futures for America. We can either head toward chaos or community. Well, that was a relevant question in 67, and God knows that's a relevant question now. All right, some of us saw the choice that we had on November 8th that Chelsea talked about as one between chaos or community. And even if you don't frame it that way, you might even say that it was a choice between more chaos and less chaos. Whatever you want to say about it, I don't know where you stand politically. But the point that King made in 67 is it's a mistake to choose chaos. And we need to have intelligence in our aspiration. Now, again, I don't know where you stand politically, but you need to consider that in Rick Perry, we have an energy secretary who once wanted to eliminate the energy department. And Rex Tillerson, a good guy, I know he is, he's been on the United Negro College Fund board for a long time and has really worked to strengthen black colleges. But some see it as a problem that we have a state, a secretary of state with oil and natural gas interests on six continents. And in Betsy DeVos, we have an education secretary who's a sworn enemy of public schools. Some see that as a movement toward chaos. And some see as a movement toward chaos the fact that we have in Ben Carson, we have a HUD secretary who says he is qualified because he grew up in the city. That's like thinking you know foreign policy because you can see Russia from your house. We need to question, are we choosing chaos? See, chaos or community, two futures. The choices were stark in 67, and I would say they're pretty stark now. And based on what's been going on, particularly in the last 48, 72 hours, feels a bit chaotic right now. But here's what King thought in 67. He said, education is the way. I'm coming at you again, CMU. Education is the way out of this. Education is the way to have moral intelligence. Education is the way to have aspiration intelligence. That's what we need, is a better education. And he said it's K through 12 education. In Where Do We Go From Here, that book, he talks about the job of the school is to teach so well that family background is no longer an issue. That's the function of K through 12 education. He turns to higher education, CMU, and he says, education without social action is a one-sided value because it has no true power potential. Are you educating here at CMU and giving graduates power potential? Are they inclined to do good even as they do well? That's the question that King wants on everybody's mind. And that's the question. Your answer to it is what reveals whether or not you have aspiration intelligence, whether or not you're more inclined to be a force for community or a force for chaos in the world. Which aspiration is your life aligned with? And is it obvious to the people who observe you and know you? What is your aspiration intelligence? How connected are you with a positive direction for this world? And then finally, I want to make a third point before I close about capital intelligence. You might be wondering, what is capital intelligence? Well, here's one thing, and this is the, some of you may have known about, obviously that book and have read it, but you may not have known about the controversy with Kenneth Clark and the Harvard scholars, but it's a pretty good guess that you don't know about this third revolution that took place in 1967 that Dr. King himself stimulated. So I'm going to take a minute on this one, because right beside the big civil rights revolution, there was a smaller, quieter revolution, and King helped to stimulate it. To set the stage for this, let me tell you that endowment is a thing in higher education today. It is the thing. An endowment for an institution is what a trust fund is for an individual. You know, it is your nest egg or your bank account, and it can give you degrees of freedom depending upon how large it is. As President Suresh noted, I sit on Harvard University's board. Now we have an endowment of $37 billion. That is, I know somebody said, shh. I say at every board meeting I'm at, I'm like, Jesus, help us. I know that CMU's is roughly $1.5 billion, and $1.5 billion is slightly more than the endowments of all black colleges, 105 of them combined. All right? That's a contrast, isn't it? And I have insisted since even before getting to the White House, though I insisted pretty much there and wrote some articles about it on the back page of the Chronicle, it does not have to be that way. Because black colleges can surge in strength too. So why do I say King helped to stimulate a point about endowments in higher education? I said it because it's true. While working at the White House, I wrote about this phenomenon not just in the Chronicle, but in the Huffington Post. And I told the story about how Dr. King was at the ground floor of this issue about endowments. And I'll tell you a story now. Back about 5 months before he was killed, Dr. King travels to Grinnell College, October 29th, 1967. And he goes there for a visit. And this is at a time in 67 when the endowments of Morehouse and Spelman and Grinnell were all about the same, somewhere around $10 or $15 million in endowment in 1967. And you fast forward, and today Morehouse has an endowment of $133 million. Spelman has an endowment of $350 million. And Grinnell has an endowment of $1.8 billion, all right? That's how the world changed. And I say King was at the ground floor. Well, why? Because on that visit to Grinnell, Dr. King travels to Grinnell on a small plane with the legendary president of Morehouse College, Benjamin Elijah Mays. Ben Mays comes to introduce Dr. King, but their plane was late. And because it was late, that gave two people in that crowd, a waiting crowd about 3,000, auditorium a little bigger than this, and two people in that crowd got a chance to get to know one another. They were seated next to each other. And one of them was the chairman of the board at Grinnell, and the other was a man who was not known then, who would become known. And they struck up this conversation. And then King arrives and he delivers a stirring speech about remaining awake during a revolution. And that happened to be the title of his final sermon on the Sunday before he was shot and killed. He preached that same sermon that he had preached at Grinnell. Little did King know that his words that day would spark a revolution, a revolutionary partnership between those two men who sat next to each other, the Grinnell board chair and his new friend. His new friend would help the board chair nurse the Grinnell endowment to the $1.8 billion where it sits now. The one who sat next to the Grinnell board chair on that day and listened to Dr. King was a man in the upper right. His name is Warren Buffett. Warren Buffett. Now, in my first week as president of Morehouse, I got in touch with Warren Buffett. And I shared with him the article that I wrote about this development in the Huffington Post. And he said to me, I sent him the article. I had the article sent to him, and he read it, and we talked. And he said, you know, Dr. Wilson, that was the greatest speech I ever heard in my life. To this day, it's the greatest speech. He said, do you have a copy? I said, as a matter of fact, I do. You buy your computer? Here it is, right here, right? Sent it to him. He shared it with Bill and Melinda Gates and all of his kids, everybody. And he said, on that day, I was so inspired that I decided, with my wife's help, that I would engage in some non-economic activity. And that became the reason why I went on to the board at Grinnell. Now, Warren Buffett never gave Grinnell a dime. All he gave them was advice. Sometimes advice is all you need. At Morehouse, a few dimes would help too, but that's that capital intelligence we're trying to get to, right? But that now positions Grinnell to have more options than most institutions. They have the highest endowment expense ratio of any college, all right? And that's where we need to go. And I know Subra Suresh is strengthening CMU in remarkable ways, and we're trying to get that capital intelligence at least one of our HBCUs. And on my watch, I need it to be Morehouse. Let me close with this. 1967 was a very frustrating year for Dr. King. He was despondent in a lot of ways in 67. He was worried. And on Christmas Eve in 1967, he was filmed and he said these words. Somebody got a camera in front of him and just talked to him. This is what he said.
That dream that I had that day has at many points turned into a nightmare.
From the dream to a nightmare in such a short period of time. The messages that come out of 67, even with King in that mode, are very, very powerful. And I want your minds this King season, this King event, I want you to be thinking about moral intelligence. I want you to be thinking about aspiration intelligence. And as Subra Suresh and the others around him and this leadership team try to strengthen CMU more and more, I want you to be thinking about capital intelligence. Morehouse College is 150 years old. Carnegie Mellon is 116, 117. And I insist that each should be well endowed enough to be able to provide the kind of optimal education to keep educating people, graduating people whose names are known. I know your graduates. I love CMU. I love what you do. Judith Resnick, right? You got some good people coming out of Andy Warhol, Leslie Odom Jr., and my favorite is Billy Porter. I love to see him on stage. I love to listen to his music. Of course, we have Spike Lee and Samuel L. Jackson and Martin Luther King and Jay Johnson and all these other people. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right. These are the kind of graduates, if we keep doing well enough and we get better and better, These are the kind of graduates that will improve the world and finally bring about the beloved community. The beloved community. And God knows we have work to do. With a new Washington, we have work to do. So let me begin to close now and take my leave. You know, as a son and grandson of preachers, we say, let me finish now about five times before we actually finish. But let me say it was a privilege to and an honor for me to work for President Barack Obama. I know Dr. Suresh feels the same way. I visited the White House for the last time on December 14th, actually. And our job was to help explore the next steps for my brother's keeper, since we suspected that the new president probably won't keep it going. My brother's keeper is part of the legacy of Barack Obama. And just being in that environment made me feel good again about the prospects for America. I was 6 days in office as the president of Morehouse when he called and said, "Do you have a graduation speaker yet?" I said, "I got one now, I hope." Right? So the first degree I handed out as President Morehouse was to Barack Hussein Obama. That's a privilege, right? But just being at the White House again in December reminded me of one of my favorite Obama stories. Now, this may sound odd, and I close with this story, but the one thing I know I have in common with Oprah Winfrey is we love the same movie scene. And it's from the 1974 film called The Autobiography of Miss Jane Pittman. If you haven't seen that, you ought to look it up and see it. And it's about how God sends us leaders. And I want to share with you that scene. It's about 30 seconds. This is Oprah's favorite scene in any movie, and it's mine too.
People's always looking for somebody to lead them. They did it during slavery. They did it during the war. And they're doing it now. They always do it in all times. And the Lord always obliges them. When a child is born, old folks look at him and ask, "Is you the one?" When Nina had her baby boy, all the folks look at him and say, "You the one, Jimmy? Is you the one?"
It's a precious scene because it suggests that every life has the potential to be the one, to be the one that takes humanity to a higher place. Be the one to usher us in, or help usher us into the beloved community toward which we all should aspire. Now, unlike Oprah, I did not get private time with Candidate Obama back in 08. So as the story goes, she had that scene in mind when she stepped to Candidate Obama in 08 and asked him this question: "Barack, are you the one?" Now, that's a dangerous question, because your answer can either make you sound arrogant, "Yes, I am the one," right? Or aimless, "No, I'm not the one," right? So you have to be careful when you answer this question, but with no hesitation, as the story goes, Barack gave a brilliantly selfless and a selflessly brilliant answer. Barack said, "Oprah, I'm one of the ones." All right? That's perfect, right? It's perfect. It has confidence and humility in it at the same time. It says, "I am able, but others are able too." It says that I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one, so let's put. I want you to all know and believe that everybody in here might be one of the ones. One of the ones that gets us to a higher place. One of the ones with moral intelligence, aspiration intelligence, and capital intelligence to bring about the beloved community and put a smile on the face of God. I want to close now with a gift, a reminder that Dr. King gave us the night before he died.
Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he has allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
That's a good Morehouse man. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
So Dr. Wilson is going to take questions. We're going to take a couple of questions because we do want to be conscientious of time. So we do have a mic, and Daniel, who didn't introduce himself initially, is going to help us with questions. So
just a couple. I know people have schedules. We promise. I think this was billed as 4:30 to 5:30, but and I'm going to hang out afterwards. So
all right, I'm going to pass the mic back, and I did not introduce myself. I'm Daniel Gingerich. I'm a PhD student here at Carnegie Mellon in Engineering and Public Policy, and I'm going to pass the mic back.
Hi, my name is Samuel Balat, and I'm a second-year student here, and we were having this discussion the other day with a bunch of my friends, and what we wanted to ask you, or I want to definitely ask you is, you know, for me, my priority is getting the best education that I can so that someday I can be in a position of power, and that's when I make a difference, and that's how my train of thought is currently. But I also struggle with the aspect of what is it that we can do now in this age? Is it more of, is your advice to us, focus on your career, your academics, to be one of the ones? Mm-hmm. Or is it, you know, make an impact now and every day, you know, throughout the process?
Well, I don't think that's a choice. I think both and. That is to say, very clearly, as you pursue your education, focus on doing well, on going deep. And, you know, if you're going to do that and do it well, you're not going to have a whole lot of time to be out in the street often and trying to make change as an activist. Often, the activist and the scholar mentality are in conflict. You need to get A's, and you need to do the right kinds of experiments and to set yourself up for superior competence. There's no substitute for that. Dr. King, this is the transformational power of Morehouse College. He came to Morehouse reading at an eighth grade level. He had been underserved by the Atlanta public school system. But in those 4 years, we closed all those gaps and he was ready for a PhD program at Crozier and then BU. So he was very intensive at Morehouse, and most guys are. I tell people, we use a quote on campus from Mark Twain: the two most important days of your life are the day you're born and the day you find out why, all right? That second day is a very powerful day, and a disproportionate number of us had our second day at Morehouse College. I had mine at Morehouse College. Spike Lee had his. Spike Lee and Jay Johnson have been back to talk to to Morehouse. They're proud of their classmate, now in present. And they both told an amazing story that you would not believe. And I'll end my answer to you with this way. Because I really do think it's a matter of having your second day to get a calling. For some people, it's very spiritual. For me, it was. I knew the day it happened that this was no ordinary day. I had just gotten, for Spike, he came back in junior year. He may have told this story while I was here, but he had gotten, and Spike had a 1.8, I think, GPA after 2 years at Morehouse. Doing everything but study, all right? But he had an experience that summer that led him to a revelation. He said, John, I know what I want to do. I said, what? He said, I want to make film. I said, you sure? He said, yeah, that's what I'm going to do. He got mostly A's from that point. I don't want to say straight A's. That might be an exaggeration. But mostly A's. Because he had his second day. So he had an intensity at that point that positioned him to do well and positioned him for the rest of what he would do. Everybody at CMU needs to be like that. All right? Now, Jay Johnson, the same thing. Only he got the bug a little. He drank the Morehouse Kool-Aid earlier. He had a 1.45 the first semester. And then he decided, he didn't tell this story as refined the way Spike did it, but he decided with all the guys around him doing well, he said, you know what? And he got straight A's from that point on, 4.0, was ready for NYU School of Law, and then the rest is history. Just stepped down as Homeland Security Secretary for the East United States. So I really want to resolve that, the tension between those two. No substitute for doing well, for focusing on your books and performing well and winning the praise and the A's of professors. And then you're set up for the rest of what you might do. You'll be a better activist and social change agent if you've gotten that brain power in the way you should. All right? That's a long answer. Go to one more question.
How you doing? Thanks for the speech. So I'm a graduate student here at CMU in engineering. And I was wondering, this is a pretty specific question. How can people in, you know, Ivies and, you know, very good technical schools connect and work with HBCUs to improve science and technology there?
Oh, okay. Morehouse has a dual degree program. We're partnered with Georgia Tech and with Michigan, and we're working on something with MIT, and we're going to work on a pipeline to CMU. We're pretty good with our IT or STEM foundation. I got a STEM PhD mathematician named Kai Campbell as my provost, and he is working to redesign it. We're working with Google and others to hopefully move very quickly toward requiring coding across Morehouse. If you major in computer science, yes, but if you major in religion or political science, we want you to know how to code too. So we're moving in that direction. So I don't want to give you an impression that we are weak. I know some other HBCUs are, but we get stronger through partnerships, and that's why I mentioned CMU, and we get stronger through having a greater profile in Silicon Valley, which we are constantly working on. I want to thank you for your attention. I hope that I was able to reveal to you something you didn't know about Dr. King. That was my goal today, and I hope you'll have in mind as you leave this event the imperatives associated with moral intelligence, aspiration intelligence, and capital intelligence, because the lessons from Dr. King certainly point in that direction. I think I'm going to hang out a little bit here, but I hope that you all go well and reflect King values and be a part of why we will soon realize, even under this president, the beloved community. the beloved community. God bless you all. Thank you.